And we're in. Hello, hello, hello. You're listening to Metal Nexus. My name is Jaime Regadas, and I'm joined here today by Woody Weatherman of the seminal group Corrosion of Conformity. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Hey guys, how y'all doing out there, man?
Right, now let's begin by focusing a little bit on the upcoming album. What can Corrosion of Conformity fans expect to hear?
Hopefully they're going to get a classic COC record. We worked hard on this thing, you know. I think getting back with Keenan these couple years, you know, Pepper came back in, and we did like two solid years of touring, you know, which is kind of unusual for not having a new record. We got to stop accepting these tours and get back in the studio. And thank goodness that thing is just about ready to bounce. It's been a trip, you know.
The album's called No Cross, No Crown. Can you explain a little bit about the symbolic connotations behind that title?
Man, you know, I think there's several meanings that people can come from. For me, you know, I was thinking it's more, you know, authority, kind of breathing down your neck kind of stuff. But for other people, you know, they may get a different meaning out of it. I think the theme's up several times during the course of the album. And hopefully, like a lot of stuff, I hope different people get a different meaning. It means something.
This is also your first... This is also your first release with Nuclear Blast.
It's also what?
Your first release with Nuclear Blast. I mean, has that been a goal on behalf of the group to be signed to that label?
Well, I think it was a big step for it because Nuclear Blast, I mean, that's a serious label. You know, those guys are working hard on the record. And, you know, from day one, once we had that, in, we knew we had to make the real record, you know, and not let anybody down. But it's nice to have guys like that behind you, getting your stuff out there. You know, it's part of what makes it all worthwhile because people can actually find your record when they hear about you. You know, it makes a difference.
So, besides authority and all that, I mean, what are the other predominant lyrical themes of the new album?
It goes everywhere. I mean, if are familiar with Keenan, I mean, he likes to dive into a lot of things, but nothing all that pointed and. You know, nothing's direct. You don't want to. It's not meant to be like a political kind of statement. You know, I mean, heck, let's face it. There's a lot of that out there. We don't do anything. I think it's, you know, it's probably more geared towards what we can do to help people. You know, help each other. Help you know, help out fellow human. Anything, I think.
Yeah, that makes sense. So. I mean, one noteworthy factor about the new album is that it's the first to feature Pepper Keenan since In the Arms of God, which was released in 2005. I mean, what's it like having his presence in the group yet again?
Well, anytime you add another person into the mix, I mean, it's like a new dynamic. And we've all worked together for so many years. It's just, you know, it's kind of just second nature, and once the riffs start flowing and the ideas start coming out, everything starts to happen. And this particular record was really fun to make because we didn't have a lot of material at all, really, before we started making the record. We were just doing in these little 4 or 5 day sessions and try to have a song or two done from beginning to end. We were just to record as we. And it was definitely a different approach for Corrosion because we weren't spending months, you know, doing demos and all that kind of stuff. We didn't even with it. Just the record kind of is the demo, you know. But it was just that we put a lot of time into it, you know.
I mean, it's always a significant landmark in a group's career to reach 10 studio albums, which, you know, is something you've finally done now, which is great. Congratulations, but. How would you describe the musical progression of the group since forming in 1982?
Oh man, I mean, whenever we started out, we were kids, you know, and I still feel like a kid, but I mean, you know, from day one, what I wanted to do was just play music, have fun doing it. You know, being able to travel was always a big part of it for me, and I still enjoy that aspect of it. But I think through the years, you know, I never thought that we would still be around. It wasn't something I was thinking about whenever we were, you know, in the early years of the band. It wasn't, you know, I wasn't thinking, hey, man, you know, in 35 years, it'll still be making records. You know, it was not forefront in my mind, but I'm just so thankful to still be able to do it and still have people get interested. You know, it's amazing for, and I feel like we've worked hard for it, but we're also kind of lucky, you know, and some of that.
Technocracy is also 30 years old now. I mean, are there any fond memories of the recording of that EP? I mean, how do you feel about it now, looking back on it?
The Technocracy EP was kind of weird because we did two versions. It was only five songs. We just did them. We did one side. You know, if you're talking the vinyl, one side we did in Los Angeles, I guess. Mm-hmm. And one side we did in Raleigh. I can't really remember where the hell we recorded that thing. One side, Ed Dean's, and Simon Bob, our buddy from the Ugly Americans, was you know, staying with us for a short period there. He was on the other side. It's kind of weird because it's really kind of the music is pretty technical. There's like, you know, tons of parts to the songs and stuff. But it was just one of those weird. It's kind of a weird EP record kind of thing, you know. But it's got some great material on it, you know.
Who were your biggest influences at the beginning?
Well, you know, to be honest, a lot of stuff that I see now, you know, I mean,
right.
Sabbath, you know, everybody says Sabbath, but of course, you know, we you know, it's evident in our Sabbath, all of that stuff, the early hardcore bands, you know, Bad Brains, Black Flag, all that stuff, you know, they were big influence on us, especially like from a live perspective. Black Flag and the Bad Brains both just sort of showed us what energy, you know, can what kind of energy you exude from the stage. That was just an important part of the development of the band, you know, especially our live show. But man, you know, I mean, I'll go back to a lot of classics. You know, I'm just a giant fan of all the big 70s rock bands, you know, but your Led Zeppelins, your Deep Purple, all that stuff, and I just, I'm a big fan. Skinner, you know, Allman Brothers, we just, I always go back to that stuff. I mean, there's a lot of great newer bands, you know, home, and I'm throwing on CDs, I'm going for the classic stuff.
Would you say it's a fair statement that the group still owes a lot to punk, whether it be from a musical standpoint or a philosophical one?
Well, absolutely. I mean, that was a big part of the early days. I mean, that's also a big part of what allowed us to go on the road at such an early stage in the band's career. We could, if you were in that sort of scene, the hardcore punk, all that stuff. I mean, you sort of had a built-in audience. Even if people didn't necessarily know the band, you could show up in, you know, Oklahoma City or wherever it was you were traveling, and there would be people there just simply because of the type of music it was, you know. There was sort of a built-in audience, which was really awesome and very beneficial to the band, you know. And it's all a big learning experience, you know, learning how to be out on the road, travel. Band, seeing all the crazy places that there were to see, and I think it played a big part, you know, the whole core scene, definitely.
How do you feel about the direction of modern heavy metal?
There's a few bands I dig. I mean, I don't really know what the direction is. I mean, I'm probably not the greatest guy to ask about that, because I don't a lot of, man. You know, it's like I said, man, I'm like I go with the classics, you know. If it's Judas Priest, I'm in, you know.
Fair enough.
You know what I mean? It's like, there's a lot of stuff that I don't necessarily follow. I get to see a lot of the newer bands just from being out on the road, you know, whether it's festival day, so forth, and a lot of it's very enjoyable. I don't really follow any trends or anything like that, though.
So, going back to No Cross, No Crown for a little bit, musically, the album is a real, I mean, it's a real conglomeration of the styles the group have always been noted for. There's elements of slow metal, punk, you know, thrash, and it may be fair to say it's one of the group's most representative albums so far. Would that be a fair statement?
I would say so, man. That's definitely a fair statement. There's elements of pretty much all the eras of the band in it. You know, there's the blister stuff, the more bluesier type elements, and then there's some of the just the straightforward kind of rocking things, you know. And I think just wanted to throw a little bit of all the things that we love about all the different types of music. We kind of wanted to follow up and throw it all in one room. It kind of came out that way, man. You know, there's nothing that doesn't sound like COC on it, but yet it's a very deep record. You know, there's a lot of different types of songs on it, which is cool.
Yeah, that's very true, because there's a lot of acoustic moments as well, and that's... I mean, who brings the acoustic elements? Whose idea was that to incorporate it into the music?
Yeah, for years, we've always thrown segments onto our albums. You know, they're just fun things to do, and we have a good time doing it. The one particular tune that's a little acoustic piece, Mantras Diem, is a Keenan creation on this record. A couple of others that we all contributed to. It helps. A lot of times the reason we do it is to make the album listenable from beginning to end. And, you know, if you're just blistering the eardrum the entire record, sometimes you can get tired of listening to the record. We want to make it where you can sit down, put the record on, and have a full hour of it from it, you know, and have its little valleys and its peaks, you know. It's sometimes those little segues really set up the next song and make it sound even better, you know.
Yeah, because I'm sure I heard you say in another interview that it sort of accentuates the heavier moments when you have a lot of soft, gentle interludes, and that's definitely something the group have explored recently, the contrast of dynamics and stuff.
Right, and so the next comes on and it sounds like a freight train.
Yeah, like, definitely.
We always have fun doing it.
Yes.
They're just fun to do, man. Those things, you know, it's like a fun diversion in the studio. You know, so you're in the middle of cutting all these songs, and then somebody's, and I got this idea, and then you spend 2 or 3 hours on it, and you wind up with a cool little segue. And it's like, okay, cool, man, that's gonna sound great on there somewhere. You know,
definitely.
It's just fun for us to do.
And it works really well. So, will there be a tour to coincide with the release of the new album?
Will there be a tour?
Yes.
Yeah, man. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes. Yeah, we're leaving in a couple weeks on this Black Label thing.
Right.
That's like a bump tour, and then right after that, they're already working on some European dates, some UK dates, and so forth. So,
are there any plans to play anything off of Eye for an Eye as a tribute to former vocalist Eric Icke, who passed away in September?
Oh, right, yeah, that was a sad deal. Yeah, Eric was a great guy, man. Yeah, you know, that's actually, I wouldn't mind it. I will toss it out there, you know, there's some good stuff on Eye for an Eye, but there's no, I don't know, I mean, we'll see. Probably not. We got so many tunes, it's like, we're kind of... stressed about what to play. So many different songs, but Eric Icke did indeed pass away here a couple months back. He was, for people that don't know, he was our the singer. He made an appearance on the Eye for an Eye album, which was released in 1984, a couple years ago. So, but yeah, he's. I didn't get to see Eric a lot the last few years, but I was occasionally in Raleigh, and he was just a nice guy. It was sad to see him go, you know.
Definitely. So, thank you for joining us here at Metal Nexus. It's been very nice having you. Sadly, that's, you know, all the time we have at the moment, but you can pre-order the album at the official Nuclear Blast website, iTunes. I think Earache as well. All of the ones. Is there anything else I'm forgetting? Amazon
all
as well.
You got your Amazons and all that. But really, you know, hit up bomb and pop shops. Some of those are your best bets.
Yeah, definitely. So, I mean, thank you very much for joining us here at Metal Nexus. We've been joined by Woodrow Weatherman. Take care until next time.
Metal Nexus.